Welcome in. Thank you for spending your Sunday afternoon, Sunday morning with us here in the suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave. What a nice view of Comerica Park, where the Tigers will be returning this week after a long way away. And after 2 weeks away, I am back in this chair that Tom Lydon so nicely, warmly kept comfortable for me. Dave Birkett, Matt Dery here in the Cave. Guys, good to be back with you.
Hey, look who's back.
Looks tan, too.
Oh, my
too,
goodness
huh?
gracious. Congratulations,
action?
Sir.
Ah. Thank you.
He's a merry man. Ring, let's see the ring. Let's see the ring. Can you put it up on the screen?
Yeah, it's really classy. It's a nice little simple band.
I like it.
She liked it, so she put a ring on it. they want it back up.
Wait, what segment today are we doing? Brad Galli wedding videos, bus ride videos from the reception?
Segment 1990, never, because people don't need to see that.
From the reception?
It was a fun time, a great time, and again, thanks to Tom for filling in and having some fun with you guys. And it's been a great time. We went to Aruba for our honeymoon.
Dave, I was there. Well, long time ago.
This guy calls me the day before the wedding. Matt, you've been texting me and everything and welcoming me back on the air the other day, so thanks. It's been great.
Yeah, no problem.
But it's been a busy week of sports while I've been away, of course. This town always buzzing with news. This is usually the time, July 1st, where the Pistons are seeking free agents. The Red Wings are making big splashes. But it's kind of been Cricket City right now with no one really making big moves. We don't know what the Wings are going to do. Helene St. James from the Detroit Free Press will join us later in the show to talk about that. The Pistons have a little bit of cap room to move around with about 13 mil. Matt, you're going to discuss that a little bit later. But we start, of course, with the Tigers and the streak of maybe them getting back on track, it looks like, at least in this past week.
Yeah, I mean, I think Dave would agree with me. I mean, this road trip has been fantastic, other than the hiccup on Friday night where they lost on the Castro walk-off homer. But Max Scherzer pitched, very, very well yesterday. The bullpen did enough to, keep them in it. And then obviously Ian Kinsler with a big bomb off of Jerome Williams, which Bo Porter, to me, should probably be fired today, the Astros manager. I have no clue what he was doing.
That bullpen shift, it's almost like he made the wrong call.
He
and then once the guy comes
in. The eighth
in,
inning, right, he pitched Qualls in the eighth inning and he got everybody out. Just send him back out for the ninth. I mean, I know you're the Astros, but like that was sort of a bizarro. It's like Jerome Williams has one career save and he comes in. And to credit to Ian Kinsler, I mean, he has had a monster trip and he's stepped up where other guys haven't. But again, it starts with starting pitching. It's been good, real good.
Kinsler's been huge too. You're right. I mean, he had that one, cold spell for about 2 weeks there. He started off the season hot, went cold. That home run yesterday, I mean, coming through big. And guys, I mean, look, they're getting big production out of Victor Martinez right now. Big production out of Cabrera. Kinsler, if they have three solid hitters like that, I think this is a lineup that can go a long way. My big question still is the bullpen, though. Joe Nathan gave one back yesterday, home run. I know he held on, they got that win, but that's still the big question going forward for this team.
J.D. Martinez has been huge, another too. One. What he's been doing player of the week a couple weeks ago, and then his emergence, I think the young guys in that lineup have kind of superseded some of the guys that are more veteran guys. I know Rajay Davis and Torrey Hunter have been two head-scratching guys of late. Do you think that's going to be a problem going forward with all these outfielders and maybe a lack of consistency from them?
It already is a problem. I mean, the issue now is not starting pitching anymore. Right now, it's been terrific. I mean, Porcello is an all-star. He is.
Yeah.
Thursday night in Texas, complete game and everything else has been phenomenal. Who would have thought that really Sanchez and Porcello were your two best starters? Throw in Scherzer from yesterday, and Verlander appears to be back, although Friday night he was okay. He wasn't the Justin of old. All of a sudden, you got a pretty good, Smiley's had a very good month of June. But the starting pitching is not the issue, which is good. But like you just said, the outfield defense is atrocious and continues to be bad. Yesterday, Rajay Davis with a bobble, and guys are taking extra bases. I think it was George Springer yesterday, the Astros. He hit second base with Davis in center field. The ball hit Davis's glove. Springer wasn't even on the bag yet, and he was going.
Yeah.
Teams are running on these guys. Torrey Hunter looks a shell of himself. That's why J.D. Martinez has to keep playing. My biggest thing is if you've got all these guys and you've got some issues in the outfield, play the best guys. But also, slide guys down in the order. I liked that Ausmus yesterday moved Hunter down. He should not be batting second as he continues to really not hit the ball that hard.
Matt, I think you're right. Look, some of that outfield defense, the issues that they're having out there, it's okay if those guys are producing offensively. They're not right now. That's the problem. Torrey Hunter has not come close to, duplicating what he did last year.
No,
and that's going to be an issue going forward. J.D. Martinez has to stay in the lineup right now. Rajay Davis, maybe you have him as a table setter, maybe number nine, that speed still plays, but I think that plays better off the bench, so they need a little bit more out of Torrey Hunter right now.
And how about Austin Jackson? We haven't even
mentioned him. Yeah,
everybody thought here in a 27-year-old guy, this was the year. They traded to get a guy that was, the Yankees' top prospect for years, and a guy that they thought throwing in that deal with Scherzer would be awesome by now.
He was hitting 300 the first few weeks of the year. I thought maybe the light came on, but he just hasn't hit lately.
It surprises me every time when they say it. At first, I guess, when Ausmus would plot Davis in, but it's making more and more sense the way Jackson has not been hitting the ball. And just a reminder, by the way, you can join the conversation. Use the hashtag 7SportsCave on Twitter. Dave's on here. His job, of course, is beat writer for the Detroit Lions for the Free Press. So we'll be talking Lions. I know the training camp's just a month away. I know you're getting really excited.
I can follow a little bit of Tigers, too.
We'll get in there.
Pistons. We'll talk some Pistons
We will talk Pistons next, but of course, and then Matt Dery, Dery 105.1. We're going to be talking about some Pistons coming up. But finishing up on the Tigers, Andy Dirks comes back in this next month as well. That outfield is the biggest thing for me right now. That's just this confounding, confusing mess with this big lack of consistency.
Bigger than the bullpen. You think that's a bigger issue going forward? Both you guys think that's a bigger issue?
For me, bullpens, I think, are the one issue for baseball fans that they always say, oh, our bullpen's terrible. There's not one fan base, I say this every week, that loves their bullpen. It's just, it doesn't happen.
I mean, Kansas City, they love their bullpen. Oakland, they love their bullpen.
It's where your scraps go. So, no, I mean, you're right to a point.
But I think the team, like when the Royals were here that week, last week, and Wade Davis and Greg Holland pitched the eighth and the ninth, it was terrific. But Kansas City's problem isn't the bullpen. Their problem is they just way too inconsistent with the bats.
Right.
The Tigers still have, for all the complaining, I don't know if I can use the B word on Channel 7, but for the moaning and groaning that we do, Miguel Cabrera, Victor Martinez are both arguably in the top five of any hitters in the American League.
Right.
Kinsler's been on fire. You still have Verlander, Scherzer, Porcello, and
Sanchez. Bottom line. Look, we got the markers out today.
Look at that.
We had arts and crafts out.
And look at the rest of the division.
They're still in first.
I mean, Kansas City lost yesterday, and they've been better, and they came in here and made a little bit of a statement, but they're still the Royals. Tigers are still in pretty good shape.
We're taking deposits now for summer camp in the 7 Sports Cave, by the way.
Well, I was going to say, I said this last week, too. Look, the Tigers, they are the best team in the division. They're going to get to the playoffs. There's no question about that. Those teams behind them, they don't have the firepower to go out and get anyone of note that's going to be a difference maker at the trade deadline. Tigers don't have to worry a whole lot. They're going to get Drew Smyly in the bullpen, you know, come October, too. So maybe that helps that back end of that bullpen a little bit.
We're monitoring your tweets about the Tigers. We're going to get into that in the next 10, 15 minutes here. But we are shifting our attention to the Pistons. Matt Dery, 105.1, the new home for the Pistons. Spencer Dinwiddie's the first pick at 38. A lot of people calling him a guy that could have been a first-rounder as a point guard out of Colorado, tore his ACL.
Yeah.
He's going to get minutes. He'll play this season.
It's weird because I was really excited about the pick. I liked it a lot, and I like that they didn't take Glenn Robinson the third.
I was sitting there.
Oh, my gosh.
Picks later,
Michigan
right?
fans, yeah. I love you. All year you bitched about him being invisible in games. All of a sudden on Thursday night, it was, how can we not take GR3? Oh, it's like Trey Burke all over again. There were a few of you.
No, Trey Burke.
That was a different story.
That's right.
I pull the reins back a little on it. But I like Dinwiddie. I think he can help. And, you know, Stan Van Gundy came on the radio station yesterday with Mark and Rick and basically said, I'm not so sure how much he's going to play and how much we can rely on him. I think Stan's all over the map with everybody's got to earn their spot. And I don't think on the 2 days after the draft he wanted to come out and go, our 38th pick is going to play. He even said, well, I need another backup point guard, which is kind of a shot at Will Bynum. He probably won't be back. But it's going to be another, I can say it's been another grueling season, but people that expect all playoffs and quick turnaround and Dinwiddie as an all-star need to pump the brakes, but I do like the pick.
Here's
my
thing
with the
pick.
You're a rec league all-star, is that right?
Oh,
like 13
God.
Leagues. Rec league all-star, Dave Birkett.
But you won't get me out on the court with you, right?
No, you don't get in the Brother Ice League, sorry.
Time. Yeah, right.
No, please, you're the brother.
Bishop Foley, if you wanted to come play in the Bishop Foley.
You don't get the Brother
Ice League. That's big time right there.
No, look, here's my thing with the pick. Look, he was a good player early last year with Colorado, right?
Yeah.
Colorado was playing well. When he went out with that knee injury, Colorado fell apart. Good player, like his size. It's kind of a Ryan Broyles type pick, though, to me, though. I mean, coming off that ACL injury, you're taking a gamble. I guess when you're in the Pistons situation and you're not expected to contend this year, maybe you can do that, give him a little bit of a redshirt year, bring him along slowly, hope that he develops into that. But I think it's a big gamble when you're taking a player that has a knee injury, coming off a serious knee injury.
I think with the Pistons, though, Dave, Arnie Kander is as good as there is in terms of rehabbing guys. And I also think that ACLs are not like they used to be.
Definitely not. But we saw with Broyles, and again, different sport, different guys. I know that happened in one knee, happened in the next knee the next year. He's trying to come back, happened to the Achilles the year after that. Just that injury history worries me a little bit.
He's a better player than Glenn Robinson III. He just
agreed.
Joe Harris and Cleanthony Early went, you know, picks, what, 5 and 4 ahead of them.
Yep.
They were on their board, too. So they got the guy that they wanted. But there were some guys ahead that they probably would have taken if they were there.
Not the excitement and buzz exactly that we were hoping for.
Second round pick.
It's a second round pick. It's what they could do with what they had. We'll get into the Pistons more. We're going to talk Red Wings a ton and free agency, what's to come. Mike Babcock can touch a little bit on the draft and what they were able to do this weekend, drafting about 15 centers, I think, the Red Wings. But Helene St. James will join us at 11:30. Coming up after the break, our buddy Jeremy Johnson is back with the people. You've heard all those cliche answers at the end of interviews after games. The people have heard them too, and they're tired. They're with Jeremy, talking on the Suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave.
The Suburban Ford Sports Cave is brought to you by Wallside Windows. We can do that. We are the factory. Parts galore. Pull your own auto parts and save big bucks. And Figer Law, trial lawyers, civil, criminal, appeals.
Send us your tweets, hashtag 7 Sports Cave. It's reading, arts and crafts, and talking sports. That's what we do inside the Suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave.
You didn't tell them that you drew those birds on there.
You were impressed by my bird drawings.
What about during the break as we discussed good China and wedding gifts with Brad Galli?
While we're here, can you guys pull up the iPad? I'm going to pull up a photo just because they're asking for it, for pictures of the honeymoon. Hold on, I'm going to get it. It's a classy one.
Better be a classic.
It's not connected.
It's family TV.
It is family TV. We'll get to it in a minute, but let's get to Mike Foss in the control room, who is our fourth member of the team, who is monitoring those tweets and was not parts of arts and crafts, but is our overseer. And Mike, what are people saying inside there? Are they sending us drawings?
Yeah, well, not quite anything as intricate as all the work and time and dedication you put into that whiteboard drawing. I saw there was a lot of time spent on that. There was a lot of detail.
Mike knows.
Exactly.
I supervised it personally. Well, we got a kind of a mixed bag on Twitter so far this morning. People are talking about the Pistons, the Tigers, the Lions. Let's jump into it. Seeing what people are saying using the hashtag 7SportsCave. Freddie talking about the Pistons, saying he'll take his chances with a 6'6 point guard at pick 38. He says the pick is already better than Austin Day, Knight, and Stuckey first rounders. Rocky, going with the Tigers angle, says Dave Dombrowski has to be very active and get at least two relievers and a new closer. Joe Nathan has been terrible. And finally, Ken with a question for Dave Birkett, talking about Theo Riddick, asking if Theo can have a real chance to play some quality minutes this year. Guys?
Interesting stuff. Let's talk about maybe the baseball trade deadline before we get to your Lions love fest.
Theo Riddick, another weapon.
People love him.
Another weapon. Needs the weapons.
What should they do at the deadline, if anything? Obviously, the bullpen help would be there. Joachim Soria is a name that I would like to see them maybe try to go acquire at the back end there. But what do you guys think the top priority would be? I mean, we talked about the bullpen again.
Yeah, I think that's it. I mean, I don't think you're going to be able to get a closer unless it's a guy like Soria. I mean, I think Nathan and Dombrowski said as much this week that he's content with Joe Nathan being his closer. But I think they need some other arms back there. You still need a lefty. I know Phil Koch, you know, he's pitched okay, I guess, of late here.
He's been great lately.
Yeah, of late.
For him.
The word great. Don't use the word great.
For him, nine of his last ten outings, he hasn't allowed a run.
Yeah. He's improved.
I'll take back the great.
He's gone from terrible to horrible.
That's great. I'll take back the great. Terrible to horrible.
Oh, my gosh. He has been better. He's been better.
And
he's hitting 97 on the gun in Cleveland the other day. He was rolling with that fastball.
That's why you don't give up on a lefty, but you still need another one back there. They need some help. They need an arm back there.
You know,
probably not three, like he said, but they need one.
You know what I would do? I would bring Joaquin Benoit back. I swear to God. I would call the Padres, who were always bad and, you know, firing general managers and everything else, and see if he would come back and stick him in the eighth inning with Chamberlain. I don't think Joe Nathan's going anywhere. I think because of his contract
and everything else.
But you would have another option, albeit you'd be the guy that, you know, messed up the Ortiz homer in the ALCS last year in Benoit. But he's familiar with the situation here. I'd see if he could come back. I'd see if you could make a deal with San Diego to bring him back.
Are you going to do the whole hashtag TF?
Oh, no.
JB?
No, the Sammy Watkins thing is dead. Thanks a lot, Brad.
I wish it would have worked.
I think Dave was on the Tufts bandwagon for a little while.
Lions wanted him. You know, if they could have found a way, but now they got Theo Riddick, right?
What kind of asset can he be like? Yeah, what can he be like in this offense?
Yeah, no, look, I mean, he's going to have a role because he's such a good special teams player for them. He'll be up, but you got to remember, Reggie Bush, Joik Bell, those guys are still ahead of him. The thing that he brings is versatility. He can play in the backfield. He can play some slot. You can use him different ways. Joe Lombardi likes him, but we'll see just how big of a role. Maybe next year he'll have a bigger role, 2015.
We promise you always that your conversation on Twitter with us drives the show. It does. Your questions will continue to take him throughout the hour, and if you've got some for the Red Wings later on, we'll talk about that. More for Dave and the Lions, we can do that too. Anything Throw it at us. What about Matt's sports cape kit?
What about the soccer shirt?
Soccer.
I'm going to the Detroit Please. City FC game today. I got to dress the part. I'm supporting a local team, Brad. You should as well.
I am. I'm supporting the
Skinny Tie Foundation.
Fraser Knit Ties.
It's the Brother Rice Basketball League. Skinny
That's right.
Ties.
The Character League. Big shout out. Well, Jeremy with the people represents everybody out there. Our buddy goes out on the street all the time, and this week he decided to go, and you know when you're sitting there, and we're used to it, when you go into the locker room, and we just tried to play our hardest, we tried to play as well as we could, and you know, it just is a team game, that's how the bounces go. Well, those answers, we're all tired of them. So Jeremy went to the people to have them do their best impressions of athletes.
Okay, thanks a lot. Well, in any sport, as you know, giving interviews is a big, big part of the game. So we decided to go around town and see how well people can do giving a post-game interview. This is going to be great. What happened? I mean, you didn't really show up to the game. I mean, you normally you're better than that.
I'm Pooh Bear. I can't be everywhere at one time.
You are like 0-4-24 right now. I mean, what's up with that?
I mean, it was a rough night.
It wasn't my fault. Sun was in my eyes.
They all played us, they all did us.
What was up with the little flagrant foul that you committed? I saw you kind of throw a little punch there. I mean, that's not really sportsmanlike.
I mean, well,
yeah, think about it. Coach had a little moment with you on the sideline. He was kind of yelling, not really that calm. He said it.
I mean, I'm not really going to say, okay, you know, right, give my coach a trouble.
Bleep, 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 blah, blah, blah. How do you think you're going to pull it off in the second half?
I feel like I come out a little cold right now. I feel like once I get my jumper going, it's going to go real rough.
You know, we're just going to go out there and try to execute our plays.
We executed.
I'm trying to execute as much as I can.
You was kind of getting into it with your teammate. What was that about?
Man, he just wasn't doing his job. He was off. He was off focus.
Nobody was helping me on the field.
It's a team effort. So if one man is not doing their job, you got to do your job better.
Michael Jordan, you know what I'm saying? Pippen, Rodman, it takes a team to play a game. One guy can't do them on his own.
What is that feeling like when you get in the zone? The zone. What is that?
It's an attitude.
I mean, I just focus on playing my game. I can get the job done.
You know, we left it all on the court, all on the ice, all on the field.
Well, what can I say? I'm a really good athlete. I love the game, and I'm doing a great job. That's why I'm getting paid for playing.
I take it that modesty isn't your strong suit.
That's very funny.
Hashtag humble.
Winners do things to win.
I always try to play the best of my potential.
All right, at the end of the day, what do you guys need to do to pull off this second half? Working on a clock, not a calendar. Anytime.
We just had to come in strong and finish hard.
That's why we played to have this game at our house in game 7. And we won't fail our fans tonight.
Yeah, man, we're going to get the championship, man. Going to get the ring. That's all that's on my mind.
What it's about.
Yep.
All right, go do it. All I know is don't forget me when you make it to the top.
I got you.
In Southfield, Jeremy Johnson, 7 Sports Cave.
Pooh Bear for the win.
Where did he find Pooh Bear? That's Pooh Bear walking the streets of Detroit out there?
I thought there was a no-fly zone downtown.
Hashtag humble.
That was awesome. Great.
We're moving over to the bar because we're doing the fast 5 minutes next. Five right. topics, we're hitting them. What the heck should the Lions do with the secondary? It's a question we have literally asked for weeks. Dave Birkett has all the answers in this beautiful sculpted
mind. Dave's got a good back pedal. Wow. I think he's ready.
He's ready to rock, and so are we. Come back right after the break.
The Suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave is powered by Suburban Ford of Sterling Heights, Michigan's largest dealer. Visit us at saveoncars.net.
Fast 5 minutes presented by Parts Galore, kicking off this edition.
Oh.
Uh-huh.
Look at that. I can't believe you came back. I would have just stayed.
From the honeymoon.
I would have just stayed.
Nice picture, Brad.
On the beach. Glorious. It was wonderful. But here I am back with these guys. Whee!
Yeah, I don't blame you.
No, hey, it's great.
I'm not mad at you.
Dave Birkett from the Lions beat job on the Detroit Free Press. Not with the Lions. You covered
you got
the
it,
Lions.
You got it.
I got that right. And Matt Dery from 105.1. I am Brad Galli here. Let's get to the fast 5 minutes. We'll start the clock with Brandon Flowers signing with the San Diego Chargers, a cornerback. A lot of fans out there wanted to see them sign. Dave, if he was plan A, what's plan B?
Well, I don't know that he was plan A. The Lions had some interest. They kicked the tires. They made a few phone calls. But he's not an exact fit for the system. If he would have come to Detroit, he would have been a nickel corner. So he wasn't going to solve all of their issues that they have at the cornerback position. Plan B, frankly, is going with what they have. I mean, I know people are a little upset about losing Chris Houston. What do you do for depth there? But really, you're going to go with Darius Slay. They're going to go with Rasheem Mathis. They're going to be their starters, and the nickel job is going to be open competition between Bill Bentley and Nevin Lawson. That's not going to scare a whole lot of teams, but that's who they're going with right now. There's not a whole lot of options out there unless you like Terrell Thomas, a guy who's coming off some knee injuries himself.
I'm not scared.
No, and I think Lion fans should be a little bit disappointed. I mean, I understand getting Ebron at 10, and he's a very, very good player, and heck, he even wants to be Rookie of the Year. But losing Chris Houston and saying Rasheem Mathis, and Dave's right, that's the choice, and he's a solid guy, and he and I talked about it on my radio show a couple weeks ago. It's not good enough yet, and especially in this division, when you got a guard, Cordarrelle Patterson and Alshon Jeffrey and Brandon Marshall. I'm still skeptical. I'm hoping that Lawson, Jonte Green, somebody steps up, takes a bull by the horns. Those are all Mayhew draft picks. All of them.
Free agency, a big part of the Lions offseason, but not exactly fitting into what fans wanted to see. Now the main event and point number two here kicks off for NBA fans. The fatigue is already hitting me. LeBron James, Dwayne Wade, Chris Bosh opting out. Matt, you love yourself some hoops. Dave, you do too.
What about Jason Kidd?
Jason Kidd, that whole story is nuts.
He's about to fly into Milwaukee and run the place.
What are the biggest storylines? What do you predict happens here?
With the Pistons?
Everybody. NBA free agency.
I think LeBron James, Chris Bosh, Dwayne Wade are going to stay in Miami. I don't think Carmelo Anthony is going to go there, though. But I do think that all those guys opting out means LeBron's still going to get the max. He'll get five at 130. But I think Bosh and Wade are going to take considerably less than what they were owed next year. I see Carmelo going back to New York or maybe even going to Chicago. Pistons names to watch for. A guy like Sean Livingston, maybe. A big point guard that Stan Van Gundy said they could look at. Didn't you name him specifically, but I see Livingston as being sort of a fit there, maybe Anthony Morrow, a shooter.
Livingston's an interesting one. I mean, they just drafted a big point guard. You know, a guy like, I don't know if it's going to happen, Avery Bradley, he's a restricted free agent. He's a great defensive player. I think he could add a little something to them, a little undersized, but, you know, I guess you get what you pay for. But as for the Miami Heat, Deez is right. All those guys are going back to Miami. They're going to go for another championship next year, another finals appearance at the very least. Carmelo Anthony in Chicago, he thinks staying in the East is the best chance for him to win.
The Heat have one player under contract for next season. One player.
Norris Cole, right?
That's it.
They got LeBron as draft choice, though, too. So
they did.
LeBron's going
back. Yeah, Shabazz Napier, that's a great call.
I joke that I'm exhausted, but it'll be fun to see how it plays out. Well, yesterday, before the World Cup game that went to penalties, I'm sitting there watching Wimbledon, even though you think tennis is dead. And let me spell it out. It is, to be fair, but I do enjoy Wimbledon. Serena Williams loses in the third round to Aliza Corney, and this is her quote. Quote, "Everyone plays their best against me, but the next time out, it won't be the same story." From her, she said it's tough to be in her shoes. Dave, is that salty or right on point?
Yeah, she's a champ. She's supposed to be a little bit bitter about losing, and she's supposed to feel that way. I mean, I don't know if that's the case or not. She is getting a little up there in age, and this wasn't the first time that this happened, so, right? So she's not going to stay on top of her game forever, but I think it's okay for her to feel that way at the very least. Look, she's a really competitive tennis player. She's a really good tennis player. Has second most Grand Slam titles in the history among women. So she's going to get a couple more of those. And she's right. Before long, she's going to get back on the winning track here.
Breakfast at Wimbledon, Matt? I brought my carafe here.
You want to know something? Serena Williams not winning at Wimbledon means that more people, whoever wins the women's title at Wimbledon, more people will know this guy, Daniel Bryan, from the freaking WWE than Serena Williams. That's what's sad is that tennis needs her and needs her sister. They are women's tennis. And for Serena to say that, I guess she is sort of right. I mean, everybody's up on their A game to try to beat her. What are the rivalries now? I guess men's tennis isn't bad. But, man, some of these sports like golf and tennis, down right now, big time.
She was the number one seed, right?
She was the number one seed. She has not advanced past the fourth round in any Grand Slam this year.
Daniel Bryan, that was for Mike Foss.
Mike Foss, I couldn't.
He's a big wrestling guy.
All right, well, hey, this one's for everyone out there. Clint Dempsey, the only one who's got a bigger head than this guy. Give me a little help here.
There we go.
Woo! World Cup, USA, big story. How far are they going to go, Dave?
He's got big ears right now, too.
Big ears.
Man, this one.
Hey, I'm handsome. I score a lot of goals.
I said it last week. Look, I'm patriotic. Team USA is losing in this knockout game here Tuesday. They are. I mean, waving them behind. Look, I like the story. Josie Altidore, hopefully he comes back. He's not going to be able to play a full game if he does because of that hamstring injury. He's a really good player. But they just don't have enough firepower to win and to advance in the knockout stage. This is where the big boys come to play. This is where Brazil, Germany, those teams really show up. USA loses on Tuesday. Sorry to say.
Yeah, I agree with Dave.
Even in your soccer uniform?
I know, and I'm all into it, but I don't. Ooh. It's been a lot of fun to watch, and I'm glad that they got into this stage, but Belgium's just better. Not that I consider like Dave and break it down, but they probably should have lost 4-0 to Germany the other day, but with the weather and with the fact that Germany wanted to hold back a little bit, Germany had the ball for 67% of the game. USA's been, it's been a great run, and I think it's good that the sport is getting some notoriety and some pub, and people are all banding together to watch it, but I don't see them being Belgian on Tuesday.
Belgian beer or Belgian soccer?
Belgian waffles. What about waffles? My man. I like that, with some chocolate chips and whipped cream on them. That's my go.
All right.
Topic 5 is a surprise that apparently I'm not aware of.
All right, Mike Foss and the fellas back in the control room. A very important summer grilling tip.
Oh, man.
Check this out. Is that outfit, especially those colored shorts, appropriate for a man's grill?
Oh, man.
Why don't we start with Brad? You start it off.
Absolutely. I think that guy, Emeril Lagasse called that man right there the greatest chef of his generation, the greatest cook. Those were his words, not mine.
I'm talking about the color of the shorts.
Fantastic. A nice coral on a nice summer evening.
Coral,
yeah.
Are you supposed to be like a wife beater and some jean shorts?
Easy, Brad Ausmus.
I got the answer here. No, those shorts are never acceptable when you're grilling out on the patio in the summer.
Hey, Dave Birkett, that's with the last word.
You must have taken it to my pickup basketball league. Not with that kind of attitude.
Do you wear those shorts when you're on the court?
You won't know because you won't be there.
Oh, man. I love that you're out there and you're right back in the swing of things. But I saw that color shorts on the internet.
I will say, I almost wore a shirt with some pink striping today.
I love it. See?
I offered it up to my daughter for her approval, and she said no. So that's why I went with the black.
That was the first barbecue at our new house. Family over for the first big grill after we got married.
You don't want to wear some like black mesh shorts, like some Lions practice shorts or something? You went with the coral?
I'm like classy, all right? The wife likes pink. Did it for you, Claire.
Wow.
Happy life. Oh, I can't argue with that.
Coming back, we're talking about wings. July 1st is the time of year where we always talk about them getting big free agents. Dan Boyle is the biggest name we're talking about. Maybe. Find out after the break. Resetting here on the Suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave. Thanks for joining us on your Sunday morning. Matt Dery, Brad Galli, Dave Birkett, all here, all talking sports with you. Join us on Twitter with the conversation. All you got to do is put the little hashtag in there, the little number sign for maybe older users out there. 7 Sports Cave, and boom, you're going to be on TV with us. Red Wings Talk is something we promised you at 11:30. Helene St. James of the Detroit Free Press, Dave's paper, we're trying to get on with us right now. She is in Philadelphia with the draft just concluding, trying to connect with her as we do await that. Could the Red Wings have found their next Pavel Datsyuk? Maybe a star rising. Dylan Larkin, a guy, their first round pick, the highest they've drafted in seemingly forever. Yeah. 15th overall. We really don't know, though. It's a lot different than an NFL draft, MLB, NBA. We don't know for a long time.
You know what? I got a big kick out of it this week. I saw ESPN. I looked after the draft, and ESPN was handing out its draft grades for the NHL.
Come on.
They gave the Red Wings a C+ out of I think it was the second lowest grade. And I'm thinking to myself, really? Have you watched any of these guys? I sure haven't. I know you probably haven't.
No. Wasn't the Lions?
I mean, it takes 3 years to properly evaluate an NFL draft. I can't imagine what the timetable is on an NHL draft. But look, I mean, they got a big forward, a guy who, he's a local guy. I like the storyline at least. Maybe he's a guy that can help down the road, but ultimately, it's going to be, 3-4 years before we see anything.
Ken Holland said that, 3-4 years
right
on Saturday.
The biggest thing is going to be last year's draft. If Anthony Mantha makes the team this year and is a impact forward and a big guy that can score goals, that's what they need. And he was drafted a year ago. Yeah, this draft, I think Ken Holland was always notorious for trading down and getting more picks. Remember, he traded the second round pick last year in the Yarncroc Legwan deal that nobody seemed to like, especially in the playoffs when Legwan didn't do anything. But now it's up to Anthony Mantha whether he makes a team. And I hope he does, because I think it would be exciting. I think the fans want to see him. But the Wings are notorious for pulling back the reins a little bit and babying guys a little bit in the AHL first.
I looked at some of the names on the draft, too, that they got this year. It seemed like something that a Ken Holland special. You know, they got some guys from different countries that they're just going to stash. And
Five centers. They traded up to get Pierre Turgeon's son, a name that NHL fans might know, played in the league for 18 years. So we're not going to talk about the draft forever here because, like you said, we don't know.
Right.
But something that maybe is a little bit juicier still, the Mike Babcock issue. He remains unsigned. So, too, does Ken Holland as far as past this season.
Right.
You had Holland on this past week on Friday. I tune in, listen when I get back, and it's the same tune. Let's get Holland's deal done, then Babcock. They both say that he wants to be here. I don't buy it, though.
Well, what was interesting was the comment I think was made was, I asked Kenny, what's the latest with Babcock? He says, we want him here. We think he wants to be here. It was very, very strange. I think what will be interesting is on Tuesday when free agency starts, if the Red Wings swing and miss and don't get a big-name guy, if Niskanen from Pittsburgh, even though you mentioned Dan Boyle before the break, if none of those guys come here and these right-handed shot defensemen go somewhere else, will the question then creep up again? Maybe some of these veteran players don't want to play for him. And is it the Babcock factor? Whereas after the season it was, this is one of the best coaches in the game, if not the best. Yet when we get to free agency the last few years, guys have gone other places. I think that's a question that has to be asked. And also, you know, Babcock may go into free agency next year. He has every right to. He's only under contract for one more year.
You know what, from Babcock's standpoint, you know, he has to look at it. If they do swing and miss on a player like that, does he want to stay for another? It's not a total rebuild, let's be honest. But, you know, they're not the elite team in the NHL anymore. And he's a guy that should have his pick of jobs. I mean, maybe there's some drawing going back to Canada for him. And maybe one of those jobs will be open next year that, you know, he wants to explore. So I think that's something that we will have to wait and see exactly what happens.
We don't know what the relationship is really like behind the scenes between Mike Babcock and Ken Holland. You guys were talking on the show. It seems like they work well together because they've won a Stanley Cup together. They've worked well behind the scenes. They've drafted well enough, I think, to exist in this league. I think we've seen that it needs more. What happens in the next 4 weeks, 5 weeks, will really show to me what their relationship is like. Because if they both lock in for a long-term future together, clearly they like to work together. If they go into this next year and have Babcock as a lame duck, I think it kind of shows where this relationship is.
Obviously, I don't think he's a lame duck.
It would be his choice.
Correct. But they've driven to Grand Rapids together to watch games. They've been all over the state and watching games. They've gone up to, you know, to see junior games. They were in Philly together. So it wasn't like, you know, they weren't working together. I think they're fine. I think the issue is does Babcock want to be here long term? That a new arena's got to go up. They have to have better facilities, and they have to have better players. I think the young guys showed last year to get him into the playoffs, they're going to be pretty good. But maybe he just wants a change of scenery, too. He's also been here 9 years.
He's been here a long time. But, yeah, you're right about that. Ultimately, that's, I think, what's going to decide it. But that coach GM, you know, point, that's – you look across all sports. You know, there's – look, those people, they're supposed to butt heads a little bit, right? They're not always supposed to get along. And it can work. Look at what's happening in San Francisco with Jim Harbaugh and Trent Baalke, 49ers in the NFL. You know, those guys – one of the best teams in the league, and those guys don't get along at all times, but it's much better if those guys are on the same page. And like you said, we don't know everything.
Let's hold that, but he was on that.
Jim Schwartz. The minute Jim Schwartz left, what did he say? I didn't have enough depth.
That's right.
Shut up.
That's a no-tough relationship there. Helene St. James is going to join us right after this break. She is live in Philadelphia with all the scoop on the draft, and maybe to expand a little bit on these points and that GM-coach relationship. She's there every day. We'll talk more with her next on the Suburban 4 at 7 Sports Cave. I have a hockey stick, so we're going to keep talking hockey. Helene St. James of the Detroit Free Press is here as Dave plays with his Michigan Panthers shirt.
I like that. That's classic, man.
I picked that up in Ann Arbor, added that to the pile.
30 years ago, right? 31 years
Dave's
ago.
Dave's taking that home with him.
Championship.
I don't think so. Hold it up. See the size. You maybe take that home for your daughter. You can trade. Sweet. Yeah, that's a schmedium right there.
There you go.
Helene joins us. Are you in Philadelphia still, or did you make it home?
I made it home.
You made it home, all right.
I was on the same flight as Ryan Martin, Yuri Fisher. That had gone down, there'd be a lot of job openings in Detroit, but
there you go.
So they gave you all the inside info then on the flight, right?
Actually, I sat next to a scout from Edmonton, so I got more of the lowdown on Edmonton.
Ooh. What does the scout think of the Red Wings?
They're impressed with how well the Wings continue to win year after year, despite, you know, 15th overall this season, or in this year's draft, was the highest they've picked in more than 20 years. I mean, it's pretty remarkable run they're on. And, you know, you saw last season how much impact young players had on the success. And those are, you know, for the most part, second, third, and lower round in the first round, lower round picks. You know, Detroit finds a way to keep winning despite never, ever being high up in the draft.
Helene, you were talking this week on Freep.com and in the Detroit Free Press about some of the names that the Wings were seeking. Dan Boyle, one of the guys, but he may command maybe too high of a price. What do you see the Wings doing in the next 24, 48 hours with this free agency opening up?
I think Dan Boyle is definitely their ideal candidate. I mean, he's got some miles on him, but if they can get him for 2 years, you know, that will kind of bridge the gap until they get Ryan Sproul or Xavier Ouellette, Backman, you know, some of these guys ready to for the NHL. So he'd be ideal. Matt Niskanen is without question the number one defenseman on the market, but I wouldn't be surprised if somebody throws 7 years and $6.5 million average at him, which is too much in my opinion. what the Wings really want is a defenseman who shoots right. Buffalo is buying out Christian Ehrhoff. He's going to be 32. You know, good guy, but he's a left-handed shot, so I don't know if they're going to be that interested in him. The other way is maybe to go the trade route, but, I mean, if they're going to go after somebody like Buffalo's Tyler Myers or Keith Yandel in Phoenix, who shoots left, by the way, it's going to cost them a Nyquist, a Tatar, a Yurko, or a Shahan. Probably, well, one of those, or a Mansa and a high-end pick. I mean, they're not going to, you know, they're not going to get them for, you know, these are prime players for the other teams are going to want a lot in return. So the ideal thing would probably be to see if you can improve on the free agent market. But it's a thin, thin market this summer.
Hi, Helene. This is Dave. Good to see you. Hey, before we joined up here on Skype with you, we were just talking about the relationship between Ken Holland and Mike Babcock. Can you shed a little bit of light on that? How well did those two get along, and what does the future hold for both of those guys in Detroit?
I would challenge anyone not to get along with Ken Holland. He's a very amenable, gregarious guy. I mean, you know, very easygoing. So, and, you know, I think people maybe don't realize how much input Mike Babcock has in decisions that are made for player personnel. I mean, it was at his pushing that they brought back Daniel Cleary last fall. You know, he was the one who liked Weiss. I mean, he gets a lot of input. So I think it's a strong relationship. You know, when that question was posed at Locker Cleanout Day in April about negotiating an extension, I mean, I think it was the furthest thing from either guy's mind. And I wouldn't be surprised to see, maybe, I'm sure Mike Babcock will stick around if he's making $2 million right now. That's amongst the highest paid coaches in the NHL. He's probably going to want more. You know, if he gets more here, he'll stick around. But if not, you know, he may end up in Toronto or Vancouver or someplace. But, you know, bear in mind, next summer, it's not like he's the only guy in the NHL who can coach. Let's see next summer if San Jose has another disappointing season. Is maybe Todd McClellan available? What's going to be the situation with Dave Tippett in the now Arizona Coyotes? You know, like, let's see who else is available. I mean, there are other coaches Detroit likes, but I wouldn't be surprised if Mike Babcock ends up getting a lot of money and sticking around. And certainly the relationship is very good between the two of them. I mean, you guys talked about them carpooling to Grand Rapids. They also shared a little short little plane ride to Sochi back in February that turned out very, very successfully for them.
What about a trade for a Joe Thornton or something of that nature? You see that happening, or is that a long shot?
No, because it's not really what they need. I mean, they've got a good group of forwards. It just was hard to tell last season because they hardly ever played all at the same time, you know. But if you have a healthy look at how much better the power play was in games 4 and 5 against Boston when Henrik Zetterberg came back and he was nowhere near full strength. I mean, you have a healthy Pavel Datsyuk and Henrik Zetterberg, you're a completely different team, you know. And then you all the support guys are going to be so much better by virtue of those. So I think especially because I'm going to bet that Daniel Alfredsson comes back. I mean, they're on a wait-and-see situation right now, how his back feels in August after he starts skating for a while. But I think they're happy with their forwards. Really, defense is where they need to address things most of all. And they don't have a ton of space. They have about $14, $15 million right now, but they have to re-sign Shahan, Tatar, and DeKaiser. So probably, I mean, if you reel in a Boyle, Boyle's not going to come in for less than $5 million a season, so there's not going to be a whole else left over.
We're not used to a summer like this with so little names out there. But, Helene, you're one of the big ones. Thanks for joining us out here on the Suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave from Michigan here back home. Thank you so much. And coming back after the break, we're going to take some tweets from everything that you guys are talking about there. We're getting some Wings feelers out there, some Tigers talk. People love that bullpen, Dave, just like you.
I'm telling you, it's a big issue.
The conversation continues after this. Thank you.
The Suburban Ford 7 Sports Cave is powered by Suburban Ford of Sterling Heights, Michigan's largest dealer. Visit us at saveoncars.net.
What a great Sunday morning. It's beautiful out there. Hopefully you're watching this on your tablet, phone, on the WXYZ app. Something.
On the deck.
Or if you're inside, go enjoy it after. But while you're here, send us your tweets, hashtag 7 Sports Cave. We just found out Ian Kinsler's getting the day off today.
Yeah, out of the lineup. He was going for 8 straight multi-hit games. He's red hot. Why? He's sitting in fair. And I know guys need days off, but the way Kinsler's been swinging the bat, keep
Andrew
playing.
Andrew Romine might be hotter.
Oh, yeah. There's a good bit.
Hey-o. Mike Foss, what's going on, bud?
Well, people are talking Red Wings on Twitter. Let's get to some of those, first of all. Most of them directed at Matt Dery. Chuck says, here we go again. D's running Babs out of town.
That's so not true.
Going nowhere. Chris is interested to get Matt's opinion on the young Red Wings. Are kids the answer? It does seem to be a men's league. And now we shift into the Brad Galli territory. Chris saying, is coral really a color, or did you just make
It's on the color wheel.
somewhere far away.
Going more complimentary, Brad clearly outkicked his coverage in the spousal department. Congrats. And some guy named Larry Galli, I don't know.
He's asking
Brad and Claire wants a grandchild. Chop, chop, let's go.
Larry,
let's see how uncomfortable we can make Brad today.
Putting him on blast publicly.
That is the worst.
Mike, it was so fun having you in the control room these past few weeks, but you're out of there, man.
There's nothing worse than, like, right after the wedding. Dave's been there, I've been there, we've all been there. And you hear somebody go, okay, so when are you going to have a baby?
That's Larry Galli.
Enjoy life. You're young. Wait a couple years.
That's awful, man.
Thanks.
I'm sticking up.
What were the sports questions? I'm lost, man.
First of all, I'm not trying to run Babcock out of town. This is a known fact. He's the best coach in the game.
Right.
And you're the Detroit Red Wings, hockey town, 23 straight years in the playoffs. Wouldn't this be a done deal to just sign it on the dotted line and have an extension going? Nothing. The longer it goes, the more this lingers. I'm not running him out of town, but I'm of the belief that I think there's a chance he could go into free agency and take a look around after the season.
How old is Babcock? You guys know? How old is he?
No,
I mean, his next contract, right? His next contract, this is going to be his big contract. He's like a player, too. I mean, why, you know, he's going to take his time. He wants it to be the right situation. Maybe that's in Detroit. Maybe it's not. It's going to be for a lot of money either way.
How about another contract sitting out there that we got a couple tweets that didn't make it to air? 30 seconds, Dave. Your thoughts on Ndamukong Suh.
Yeah,
where are we,
coming.
Man? Camp's coming up. You know that's going to be asked 100 times.
Camp's coming. Still waiting. Still waiting for him to get it done. Look, I still think it's going to happen. I'm not guaranteeing it by any means. I think it happens before the start of the season. If it doesn't, I think you say goodbye to Ndamukong Suh next year in free agency.
Ooh. We need to, like, slow that down with some, like, dim lighting and black and white and have that
sad
there.
About it.
What about the old classic? He couldn't show up for voluntary workouts, but he was at the World Cup.
There you go. So is Matt in his uniform.
When
we come back, we're talking our final thoughts of the week, what was really inspiring us, and hint, it was not soccer.
Why not?
Maybe. We'll be back after this. Maybe it was soccer. Sorry.
The Suburban Ford Sports Cave is brought to you by Wallside Windows. We can do that. We are the factory. Parts galore. Pull your own auto parts and save big bucks. And Figer Law, trial lawyers, civil, criminal, appeals.
Welcome back inside the Suburban Ford 7 Sportscape. Thanks again for making this the spot to start off your Sunday morning. What a beautiful day it is outside, and what a fun time it has been in here.
We need some windows in here.
We do need some windows, but it's
you
a cave.
It's a beautiful day. I have no clue.
It's a cave. Just the boys and the girls that are watching. Thanks for watching, too. It's been a fun week, but there's also some serious stuff that's been going on. Dave, shine some light on maybe something you want to talk about this week.
Yeah, well, you may have missed it while celebrating the United States 1-0 World Cup loss to Germany, or while feverishly searching the internet trying to figure out who in the world the Pistons just drafted. But the most important event in American sports happened a few thousand miles away this week when Ed O'Bannon's trial against the NCAA came to its quiet conclusion in a California court. No verdict has been rendered yet, and once it is, it no doubt will be subject to countless appeals. But both sides rested, with only a few filings left, in the case that will shape the future of college sports. I'm admittedly a bit on the fence when it comes to what I think should happen. As a consumer, I like college sports the way they are, and I think a free education is a pretty good salary for most 18, 19, and 20-year-olds. As an American, I know players, not schools, should be able to make all the money they can off their likeness. As for the legal side of it, the particulars of antitrust law are a little too complicated for me or Brad to grasp, not D's. But I do know after 15 days of trial with smart lawyers making persuasive arguments on both sides, change is coming. And no matter the degree, that's a good thing.
And Matt, touching on something else.
Yeah, sticking with the college theme, I really am of the belief that Michigan football has to start winning some football games and doing it this year. Brady Hoken, year four, it's a very important season for U of M. But I was talking to some people this week that said, hey, listen, did you realize it was sort of something under the radar, but if you look at the Michigan roster, Blake Countess, their best cornerback, and he's a good player, is going to be wearing Charles Woodson's number 2. I think that's a mistake. I think we got to stop in Ann Arbor with the gimmicks, the Oosterbond jersey, the Tom Harmon number 98 that Devin Gardner's wearing. Heck, it was this week that Shane Morris said, I'm competing for the starting quarterback job. Those guys that should be wearing those jerseys should be the end-all, be-all best players on the field. Countess is a good player, no offense to him. But he was second team all league last year. Number two should be worn by an All-American lock guy that you know is great. Devin Gardner should be wearing number 12 again to get back to who he is, not trying to be Tom Harmon. We needed Michigan to start winning some football games, not losing 11 games like they have the last two seasons total. And stop with the gimmicks and just start winning.
It would be nice if winning was the priority instead of the gimmicks, like you say.
The legend jersey's got to go away. Go back to just doing what you do.
Earlier this week in Macomb, I was asked to come be the grand marshal of the biggest 5K in Macomb County. I'm going to stay away from sports a little bit and kind of put together just a note to the community of Macomb. 1,600 people came out for Run the Plank 5K, and you can pull up the picture and just see what a great time it really was with these group of people. Three churches combined to support 30 charities in the area, including helping homeless teens in the area. By far the coolest run I have ever been a part of, and to be quite frank, on the starting line, when all these people, young and old, are walking out there, getting on the starting line, shed a little tear just to see these people come together. I saw my old 7th and 8th grade baseball coach, Dominic Campisi. Just a great, great event to really help people in that community, and especially people without a home, trying to give them education. So a big tip of the hat to the entire Macomb County community, because it was a really special event to be a part of, and I thank you for having me out there.
Good work, buddy. Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
I didn't know you're such an athlete.
I did. Yeah, because you still haven't gotten that invite to play basketball.
Right? I know.
It was a 5K. I didn't say I ran it. I did a little run, a little walk, but tried to run.
He's taller than people don't give him credit for.
That's the number one thing people say to me on the streets.
On the streets? If you invite Dave to your little brother Rice basketball league, will you post him up? Are you more of a perimeter guy?
Come on, Deez. You've seen me play. You can't post me up.
You got the elbow?
I always guard the slowest guy. Sorry, Nick. I always guard the slowest guy. Thanks to you guys for coming in. Dave Burkett's on Twitter at Dave Birkett. You can read his work on the Lions as the beat writer in the Detroit Free Press and on freep.com. And Matt Dery is on live at 105.1 every single weekday, 2 to 5?
Noon to 3, and I'll be on 3 to 7 this week, filling in on Afternoon
Drive.
That's
why you were different.
And I'll be at the Detroit City FC game tonight.
Great to be back with you all. Thank you for joining the conversation. Great to be back in the cave with you guys. See ya. Dave's back with us next week, too. 18 weeks ago.